Now, we talked about a superior view of the cranial base. It's also important to think of an inferior view of the cranial base. So if you're thinking on the bottom right here, and this is really where you're seeing the exiting of some of those cranial nerves that we talked about previously. So let's talk a little bit about some of those we saw before. You have your foramen ovale. Remember, the third division of your trigeminal nerve is going to exit there. Right here, you have this large jugular foramen. So right in this region, at this point, for inferior, you're talking about the internal jugular vein. So all those dural venous sinuses have drained, and now we have the internal jugular. And then lastly, you have your foramen magnum in this region. So at this point on, we're talking spinal cord. We're not talking the brain stem that you had within the skull. There's a few other features I really want to talk about in this view. The first and probably the most prominent is your hard palate. Okay, so we're going to talk about the two main bones that form this. Now, there is a specific bone, a pair of bones referred to as the palatine bones, but they actually don't form the majority of the hard palate. The majority of the hard palate, the anterior portion of the hard palate, is actually formed by your maxillary bones, okay? So your maxillary bones, which are going to form a big portion of your facial skeleton, also form the majority of your hard palate. And that makes sense because that's where your maxillary teeth are going to be held. Now, in some individuals, you can see a clear suture line. You can see a little remnant of one right here. And then the posterior portion of the hard palate are these paired palatine bones. Now, what's going to be posterior to the hard palate is your soft palate. So you'll continue on with the soft palate, then you'll have that uvula, or what we think of in terms of our tonsils, are going to be hanging in the back there. You'll talk a lot more about tonsils when you get into the lymphoid discussions. All right, so that's the hard palate right here. Continuing on in terms of a few other structures I want you to notice, you see this fairly distinct divot or depression right here. This is referred to as the mandibular fossa. This is going to be the cranial portion of your temporomandibular joint. So that mandibular condyle is going to sit right in here in order to allow for you to open and close your mouth, as well as project and retract your mouth as well. So mandibular fossa right here. One thing when you're looking at an actual cranium, and this is an actual cranium, oftentimes a lot of things are lost postmortem. You'll have portions of the teeth that are lost postmortem, and any projecting portions of the skull are also going to be lost. And usually one of the first things to go is the styloid process. So you can see a little stump right here. Typically the styloid process will extend to about here in living individuals. So you have this thin portion of bone referred to as the styloid process. Important in terms of muscle attachment associated with the hyoid, as well as with muscles associated with the tongue. Now right here, and we'll look at this again in a lateral view, is your mastoid process. And you can actually palpate the mastoid process on yourself right underneath your ear. You feel that portion of bone right there? That's your mastoid process. That's what this is. The mastoid process is a sexually dimorphic trait. So typically males will have longer and larger mastoid processes. Within, it's fairly hollow. You're going to have what's referred to as mastoid air cells. And the mucosa that's associated with that can get inflamed. So if you've ever heard the term mastoiditis, it has to do with the inflammation of the air cells here. Also importantly, you have a large muscle that's going to attach here, your sternocleidomastoid muscle, one of the worst names in the history of anatomy, but a very important muscle in terms of your neck, this rope-like muscle right here. This is going to be the superior attachment of that muscle. All right, the last thing I want you to note in this view, right here, right next to the foramen magnum, you have what's referred to as your occipital condyles. These condyles are going to articulate with your first cervical vertebrae. So you're actually having attachment to your vertebral column in order to protect that spinal cord. So these occipital condyles are articulating with your first cervical vertebrae. Sometimes we refer to that vertebrae as Atlas. Think of Atlas holding the world on his shoulders. That's what that's going for there. And that this allows for you to be able to say, yes, all right? So that allows for that movement right here.